Few people can look at what is left of the Catholic Church today without acknowledging that something is very wrong. In the wake of the Second Vatican Council, there has been a notable decline in all the life signs of the Catholic Church. Baptisms, conversions, church attendance, and religious vocations have all plummeted. Instead, the Church of today is identified with irreverence, abuse, scandal, and cover-up. Many understand that there is a problem. Yet few seem willing to understand the reason why. Attempts are made to address the problem. However, most of these attempts are doomed to failure because they are only addressing the symptoms. They fail to deal with the underlying disease that is the root cause of those symptoms. But just as a disease cannot be properly treated unless it is first correctly diagnosed, so it is also true that none of the problems in the church today can be properly addressed unless they are first correctly identified. Even the most basic assessment of the Novus Ordo Church reveals it to be an entirely new religion. It has incorporated new doctrines, new laws, and a new worship service, which are in fact opposed to the Catholic faith. Even in the face of mounting evidence to the contrary, most people insist that the Novus Ordo Church is still Catholic. They simply cannot bring themselves to admit that the Second Vatican Council abandoned the Catholic faith and replaced it with a new counterfeit church, and that the majority of Catholics have, perhaps unwittingly, abandoned the Catholic faith to accept this new counterfeit church. Although the Novus Ordo Church preserved many of the outer trappings of the Catholic Church, like any counterfeit, the resemblance is only skin deep. That is, it has an outer appearance of being Catholic, only as long as you do not examine it too closely. The Novus Ordo Church still calls itself Catholic. However, regardless of what it calls itself, it is evident that the Church in Rome no longer professes the Catholic faith. It is beyond all doubt a counterfeit church, and a counterfeit church should be treated the same way we would treat counterfeit money. Nevertheless, the sad reality is, most Catholics simply accepted this new counterfeit church, no questions asked. Some were attracted by the novelty of the changes and were eager to embrace all the modernist innovations. There were still others who did not like the changes in the church. However, because they believed that these changes came from the legitimate hierarchy, they reluctantly accepted them. They devised creative ways of interpreting the novelties of the council in an orthodox sense. In a masterful display of doublethink, many were able to convince themselves that nothing has really changed. But regardless of whether they embraced the revolution eagerly or whether they accepted it only begrudgingly, in the end, the vast majority of Catholics came to accept the new counterfeit church as if it actually were the Catholic Church. Yet this new church was not embraced by all. There was a small remnant of faithful Catholics who opposed the revolution of Vatican II and tenaciously clung to their Catholic faith. Those faithful Catholics who refused to accept the new counterfeit church are called traditional Catholics. Traditional Catholics want nothing more than to hold fast to the faith of their fathers. But this presents a dilemma. On the one hand, a Catholic is required to be in communion with the Pope. On the other hand, a Catholic is also required not to be in communion with heretics. This poses an apparent contradiction. All the heresy and error of the counterfeit church was officially promulgated with the authority of the post-Vatican II popes. If one accepts the counterfeit church of Vatican II, they are in union with heretics. On the other hand, if they reject the counterfeit church altogether, they are accused of rejecting the teaching authority of the Pope, which would make them schismatic. How does a Catholic reconcile his obligation to obey the Pope with his obligation to reject heresy? This perplexing question has become the cause of much division in the traditional movement. It has split the resistance into two main camps. those who accept the Vatican II popes as valid popes, and those who reject them as counterfeit anti-popes. The position that accepts the validity of the Vatican II popes is referred to as recognize and resist. That is, they claim to recognize the hierarchy of the new church, yet they feel free to openly disobey it. They hold that a Catholic's conscience is only bound to assent to those teachings that are in conformity with tradition. They define tradition as those things that have been believed always and everywhere. They contend that, as long as they acknowledge a pope, they are free to resist his directives. They sift his teachings, decrees, laws, canonizations, and liturgical rites, and accept only those parts they judge to be in line with what the Church has taught in the past, and reject whatever they judge to be a novelty. They also feel free to ordain their own priests and set up competing mass centers in open defiance of the man they acknowledge as pope. This is the position advanced by Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre's Society of St. Pius X. The problem with such a position is that it is not Catholic. In the name of tradition, they have placed their own judgment as a higher authority than that of the Pope.
Archbishop Lefebvre was really wise to establish the society because within the society there's a hierarchy. I have to obey my superior.
Rejecting the authority of the Pope and setting up an independent hierarchy is the textbook definition of schism. In that time, immediately following the council, the correct answer was not immediately evident. The situation was unprecedented, and many Catholics found it difficult to explain exactly what was wrong in the church. They just knew that the changes introduced after the Second Vatican Council violated their Catholic sense. In this time of confusion and uncertainty, when good Catholics were still sorting through the complex issues and trying to make sense of the contradictions of Vatican II, the recognize and resist theory was introduced as the answer to this crisis. One does not want to be too critical of confused Catholics who hold the recognize and resist theory in good faith. Nevertheless, sincerity does not change the fact that this thesis contains dangerous errors and is completely incompatible with the traditional Catholic teaching on the papacy. The recognize and resist faction insists that the new counterfeit church is somehow Catholic. But there are consequences to accepting a counterfeit church. This new church has not only promulgated a harmful and invalid rite of mass, but it teaches many heresies, such as religious liberty and false ecumenism, which are completely opposed to the Catholic faith. However, rather than rejecting the counterfeit church, the recognize and resist faction rejects the traditional Catholic teaching on the papacy. They scrutinize the teachings of the new church and judge for themselves which of its teachings they will accept and which they will reject. But such a system is incompatible with the Catholic faith. It wrongly places their private interpretation of tradition as a higher authority than that of the Pope.
We promote the teaching of the Pope, in which case we abandon the tradition of the church in this regard, or should we rather reject the teaching of the Pope and say that we're going to follow tradition?
The recognize and resist position is worse than just a misguided understanding of tradition. It is a complete redefinition of what is meant by Catholic tradition. When the First Vatican Council was discussing the doctrine of papal infallibility, the Archbishop of Bologna proposed adding that the Pope is assisted by the Council of Bishops, manifesting the tradition of the Church. But Pope Pius IX rejected this proposal, responding, "Tradition? I am tradition. The traditions of the Church are just the teachings that have been handed down from the popes of the past. To place a higher importance on the teachings of the past is to deny that each pope is the living successor of Peter with the same authority to teach. To reject the current tradition in favor of the past implies that the current pope does not possess the same authority as his predecessors, but such a position was condemned at the First Vatican Council." Quote, "If anyone says that it is not from the institution of Christ the Lord himself, or by divine right that the blessed Peter has perpetual successors in the primacy over the universal church, or that the Roman pontiff is not the successor of Blessed Peter in the same primacy, let him be anathema. If Paul VI were a true pope, then he was the successor of St. Peter possessing the same primacy. That means that when Paul VI promulgated the Novus Ordo Mass, he did so with the very same authority with which Pope St. Pius V promulgated the traditional Latin Mass. The Society St. Pius X is willing to grant that the Roman Pontiff is the successor of Peter, but they depart from Catholic teaching because they reject that he is the successor in the same primacy as Peter. Accepting a heretic as pope has consequences. In order to have their pope, the recognized and resisted faction must reject the dogmatic teaching of Vatican I on papal primacy. When the recognized and resist faction claim that they are following tradition, what they mean is they are rejecting the traditions of the current pope in favor of the traditions of past popes, but this is a condemned proposition. Consider the apostolic letter, Epistola Tua, of Pope Leo XIII. Quote, "It is to give proof of a submission which is far from sincere to set up some kind of opposition between one pontiff and another. Those who, faced with two differing directives, reject the present one to hold to the past, are not giving proof of obedience to the authority which has the right and duty to guide them, and in some ways they resemble those who, on receiving a condemnation, would wish to appeal to a future council or to a pope who is better informed." A Catholic is simply not allowed to reject the teachings coming from the current pope in favor of the teachings of past popes. If Paul VI were a valid pope, as the recognized and resist faction insists, then he was in possession of the very same primacy as all of his predecessors, and therefore, Vatican II and the Novus Ordo Mass are the tradition of the Church. They claim to follow tradition, and yet they do not accept the traditional Catholic teaching on papal authority. They have redefined tradition to mean whatever the Church has always taught in the past. But one cannot reject the authority of one pope without rejecting the authority of all popes. For if the current pope does not have a binding teaching authority, then by what authority did the popes of the past bind Catholics? The recognized and resist faction have devised a scheme to justify their disobedience. They claim that Vatican II was only a pastoral council, and therefore, the pope did not exercise his infallible authority.
Both of the popes who were involved with it, John XXIII and Paul VI, made exceedingly clear, as we'll see, that their intention was precisely to keep it to what they called a pastoral council. Meaning, in other words, that charisma and infallibility was not, at least in that extraordinary manner, not present.
They contend that if it is not infallible, they are not bound to accept it. However, this is not Catholic teaching. Just because something is pastoral does not mean that it is not binding. The idea that one is only bound to accept infallible pronouncements was condemned by Pope Pius IX in the Syllabus of Errors. Condemned Proposition number 22 of the Syllabus of Errors. Quote, "The obligation by which Catholic teachers and authors are strictly bound is confined to those things only which are proposed to universal belief as dogmas of faith by the infallible judgment of the Church." When the recognized and resist faction teach that they are not bound to assent to Vatican II because it was not infallible, they are teaching the very thing condemned by Pope Pius IX in the Syllabus of Errors. In fact, what they are teaching is actually a kind of counter-syllabus. Once it is clear that someone is teaching a condemned proposition, they should be avoided by Catholics. Even if the teaching of the council was not infallible, it is still part of the ordinary magisterium. A Catholic's obligation to assent to the ordinary magisterium is not a matter open to debate. The recognize and resist faction operates in open defiance of the man they recognize as pope, and yet, regardless of this contradiction, they still claim to be Catholic. However, there is more to being Catholic than simply claiming to be Catholic. For their claim to be valid, they must have the four marks of the Catholic Church. We know that the Church must have these four marks, both from the tradition of the early church, as well as from the words of our Lord given to us in sacred scripture. Like a trademark, the marks of the church are a means of distinguishing the true church of Jesus Christ from a counterfeit imitation. The four marks of the Church of Jesus Christ are 1. Holy, Catholic, and Apostolic. Regardless of what it calls itself, any church that does not have these identifying marks cannot be the Catholic Church. Consider the first distinguishing mark of the Catholic Church. The Church is one. By this is meant that the Church is one in its faith, one in its government, and one in its worship. The Baltimore Catechism tells us that the Church is one in its faith because all Catholics throughout the world believe each and every article of faith proposed by the Church. Is the Society of St. Pius X one in its faith with the Novus Ordo Church? No. They reject the decrees of Vatican II.
With our own eyes, we can see the novelties and the doctrinal errors that are present in Vatican II.
They also reject the new Code of Canon Law, the new Catechism, and many of its new canonizations.
We have a problem with that doctrine. It's not Catholic. Therefore, right. We have a problem with Vatican II.
Furthermore, the Baltimore Catechism tells us that the Church is one in government. For the faithful in a parish are subject to their pastors. The pastors are subject to the bishop of the diocese, and the bishops of the world are subject to the Pope. Is the Society of St. Pius X one in government with the Novus Ordo Church? No. They openly defy the man they acknowledge as Pope. They ordain priests and bishops against his express will and set up independent chapels that compete with the Novus Ordo for attendance.
Because we are saying to the authority, I'm going to keep celebrating Mass and I'm going to keep giving the sacraments, even though you haven't given me your approval. And the faithful are saying to the authorities, well, we're going to keep going to the society, even though you haven't given your explicit approval to them exercising their sacred functions.
And finally, the Baltimore Catechism tells us that the Church is one in worship because all of its members make use of the same sacrifice and receive the same sacraments. Is the Society of St. Pius X one in worship with the Novus Ordo Church? No. They completely reject the new order of Mass, calling it a danger to faith.
That the new Mass represents a danger to the faith.
The Society of St. Pius X claims membership in the Novus Ordo Church. They acknowledge Francis as their Pope, yet they hold a different faith than their Pope. They ordain priests and operate chapels in open defiance of his express wishes. And they refuse to use the officially promulgated worship service of their own church. It is beyond all doubt that the Society of St. Pius X is divided in faith, government, and worship from the church they claim membership in. It does not matter what they call themselves, or if they have beautiful churches, traditional vestments, and a Latin Mass. Piety and conservative dress are not a substitute for sound doctrine. Any church that does not have the mark of unity cannot be the Catholic Church.
There are consequences to holding to the recognize and resist position. The Catholic religion, having been revealed by God, must be in conformity with right reason. In logic, the law of the excluded middle tells us that a thing is either true or it is not. Therefore, reason tells us that Francis and the other five post-conciliar popes are either true popes or they are not. If they are true popes, Vatican II and the Novus Ordo Mass are the tradition of the Church, and all Catholics would be required to submit to them. On the other hand, if they are not true popes, but actually anti-popes, then they should be completely disregarded. An anti-pope would have no more authority to command in the Church than would an Anglican or Lutheran. A counterfeit pope should be treated the same way we would treat counterfeit money. However, the recognize and resist faction take a kind of middle ground position. They recognize the Vatican II popes as true popes, but they resist them and treat them as if they were anti-popes. The recognize and resist faction wants to acknowledge a pope without also accepting the consequences of having a pope. This middle ground position is not only opposed to the traditional Catholic teaching of the papacy, but it is also opposed to right reason. The recognize and resist position is actually a systematic denial of the Catholic teaching on the papacy. It essentially rejects the teaching authority of the Pope, replacing it with their own private judgment. They claim to follow tradition. It's just not Catholic tradition.
I'm being faithful to the spirit of Archbishop Lefebvre.
Archbishop Lefebvre, he would always say,
the Archbishop would say,
I'd maybe like to cite Archbishop Lefebvre again.
The Archbishop said,
we're just following Archbishop Lefebvre.
Archbishop Lefebvre would say,
they claim to follow tradition. It's just not Catholic tradition. They follow the tradition of Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre. In the recognize and resist system, each Catholic must become a Pope checker. They must examine the teachings of the Pope to make sure that they conform to their own understanding of tradition. It makes each Catholic, or the recognize and resist cleric of your choice, a higher authority than that of the Pope. They are not unlike a Protestant who brings his Bible to church so that he can check to make sure that what his pastor is teaching conforms to his own understanding of the Bible. But such a system is absurd. If it were possible for the Pope to teach and err on a matter of faith and morals, then the papacy would be worse than useless. It would be a danger to your faith. The motivations behind the recognize and resist theory may have been noble in the beginning. However, in the end, the motivations are not relevant. An error that is introduced in good faith and an error that is introduced with malice are both error and equally harmful. If the modernists had set up their own controlled opposition, they could not have done a better job of dividing and neutralizing their resistance than the Society of St. Pius X. Not only do they stubbornly defend the modernists in Rome as the legitimate hierarchy, but they viciously denounce as heretics all those who reject them as false. The recognize and resist theory has aided the modernists, divided the traditional movement, and spread dangerous errors about the papacy. It makes each Catholic a higher authority than that of the Pope, with the duty to resist him to his face. Who needs the modernist errors when you have the errors of the semi-traditionalists? This issue is of no small importance. The failure to correctly identify the problem has only added to the confusion. Just as a disease cannot be properly treated unless it is first correctly diagnosed, so none of the problems in the church today can be addressed unless they are first correctly identified. Any hope of a restoration of the Catholic Church must begin first with the correct diagnosis of the problem. Catholic Crusader Films is solely responsible for the content of this video. For further information on traditional Catholicism, visit cmri.org or novusordowatch.org.
Credamus omnes.